The Horde of Zendar.
Indeed.
Hey Simon, how are you doing today?
Okay, yeah, pretty cool.
Yeah, great. I'm so happy to have you on the show, man. Well, most people aren't aware, but we had our first interaction actually back in 2018, and
oh, yeah.
I was streaming Arcane Dimensions on Twitch, and you know, I was just playing it, having a blast, and then some guy named in the chat with the handle, you know, Simon OC popped up, and he was like, "Oh, hey, I'm happy to see you playing this." And I was like, "Oh yeah, cool, yeah, sure, yeah, this is pretty fun." And then, you know, I had no idea who you were at the time.
Oh, yeah. I did that quite a bit. People often send me links to AD videos, and if they were live, I would actually go and join because it was actually quite cool to interact, see how they were getting on. Sometimes they'll get stuck. Sometimes they want clues, or I don't know, it depends. I mean, Twitch streamers are all different. Some don't like any contact. Yeah, it was cool. I tried to get involved as much as possible.
I had no idea at the time, obviously, who you were, just because I was not really a member of the Quake scene. I was just a player, you know? I just heard of this cool mod, and I was trying it out and having a blast, and before I jump into this whole map and the video and stuff, for people who've played this and maybe some of your other maps, like the difficulty select screen for the id 1 version of Zendar is in the map itself, and I had no idea how you pulled this off until you told me how you did it, and yeah, it makes total sense. Did you want to go over that real quickly?
Yeah, it's using the id start map, where if you have a rune and you come back to it, you start in a different position. So there's a second start point. So if you give the player a rune at the very beginning, they then will start using the second spawn. So it's just a way of creating a little loop inside your map. It works really well. It's something you don't really need to do if you have your own mod or something like that, because you can have your own start maps. But it was just... often people never select the right skill level, and they played it and didn't want that skill, and it sort of gets you into the map, I think, in a better way. It's sort of stops you having to drag down the console and take yourself out of it in a way. But yeah, it's trying to set the mood, really.
That's definitely happened to me, where someone has sent me a map to play or demo, and then I load the map up and I just start playing, and then by the time I'm three-fourths into it, I'm like, oh shoot, I forgot to change it to skill 2.
I know, yeah. It happens to, I think, a lot of people, because you get so involved with it simply because of the action and the way the encounter's set up that you just forget completely about it. And you know, sometimes you want that actual surprise to be the right skill levels. It's just a way to sort of get people into that mindset. And I sort of discovered it by accident on my very first map I released, Midnight Stalker, and it was sort of something that was popular, so I just carried on doing it. All my maps vanilla.
It's a really neat touch, and it was really mind-boggling for me until you explained how it worked. I was just looking at it, just tearing my hair. I was like, "How did you do this? This doesn't make any sense."
Yeah.
Okay, so
magic and stuff.
I'm gonna be a little brave here and pick skill 2 hard, and obviously for those watching, you know, this is how you get Nightmare. I guess I'll just show it for completion's sake. But yeah, we're going with, I'm going with skill 2 here. Alright, well here we go. The city of Zendar. So, as I sort of lightly touched on earlier, we are actually playing the id 1 version of your map, which I believe is called the city of Zendar. Whereas the Arcane Dimensions version is called the Horde of Zendar, right? Or are they the same map? Are they both the Horde of Zendar?
They're both the Horde. I suppose the map title itself is describing the inhabitants of the city. Oh. And when you start, it's actually trying to lead you into the city. So it's there's a whole backstory in the README file where you can sort of talks about how the city started and how it was on a trade route and you're basically visiting this city. It's something you heard about. So the Horde bit is is the bit you at the end of it, such. It's like the final title.
Okay.
It's just the way it leads you in a way.
So, for some of us who may have not seen the readme yet, from where did the concept of Zendar and this map in general emerge?
I used to play a lot of WoW for a couple of years, and they used to have like a really good sort of like Horde style like server names. One of the server names was Zendar.
Oh.
And I sort of liked that, and it has like a really good like ring to it with the name. It's like Zendar. It's like, you know, something you could shout or scream.
Oh, and the word Horde, the word Horde is also a nice little play on words there.
Exactly.
I would have never have realized that. Because I also played a ton of WoW for the longest time. I never would have caught that.
Huh. Yeah, so it was sort of like from there. But most people don't overlap between Quake and WoW, so most people won't know it.
Uh-huh. And also, it wasn't until me replaying through this id1 version where I ended up finding like more stuff. Like, there's a path back onto this main bridge right here with these jutting bricks.
Oh yeah. There's the ruin down at the bottom. You can climb it. There's some bricks at the back of the ruin. You can see it down there.
Oh yeah, this too.
There's some bricks here. You can climb right up here, and then that's the route up. You see, so you can completely avoid the invisible ring and the front, and you can literally just go straight through into the map if you really want.
Huh.
There's like a choice in a way. So you can even start the very beginning in a different way if you wanted.
And a little prior, you actually sent me a concept art piece that I believe it sort of might have been the inspiration for this like outer ring of the city, right? Like it was like a canyon with some arches, right?
Well, the front of the map didn't really start for a very long time. I generally try and leave the beginnings and the end of the map to last, and I couldn't find a way to actually, because the map didn't even start as a city. It was prefab scraps left over from like Ivory Tower, which is a previous map. Mm-hmm. So this whole city idea wasn't even born at the very beginning. And this is all from like a concept art. There's a user on Funk who posted an image, Madfox, and he posted an image of like a canyon with like a big, huge arch. Because I did have other versions of this bridge. This isn't the only version. There is other versions I have. And this is the one that actually stuck the best, because it sort of like was the most impressive. And it also matched the rest of the architecture inside the city as well.
And it's really it's like really beckoning, like a sort of beckoning image. Like it's like teasing you, like, you know, like come on in, you know, like. And then I always thought that was really neat, is that you try to maybe interact with this door and it doesn't open, and then you're sort of left with like a, huh, okay, I got to find another way in. And then
that's like, does the cliche, like, you know, go in via the lower route idea.
I just think that's such like a, it's really clever though, because it forces the player to look at the map. Like a lot of times when I'm like, I've noticed that this is a problem in some games, like a lot of games actually, is that the set dressing is incredible, but nothing about the game design itself draws your eyes to the set dressing, because you just get hard railroaded maybe down a super focused linear path to where everything is just flying past your head, over your head, through your ears, you know. And I always liked that sort of abrupt buckling expectations of,
mm-hmm.
Like it sort of like breaks the player out of their game trance to almost like be like, oh, okay, well, I'm here, you know, I exist here, what do I do next? And this is a great moment for that to happen, because it's like the initial facade, right?
Yeah, so try and make the city feel bigger than it is, in a way. It's to try and make you feel like there's actually more going on around you, in a way, or that it's not just simply like a small loop inside. There's actually a city there, in a way. And like when you first come out of the cave, the first thing that I do is give you an encounter which makes you look up.
Yeah.
The Scrag is straight away there, and he's hiding, he's waiting. It's like it's there to literally make you look up. because players notoriously never look up. So yeah. it's a way of just like pulling you upwards. And then once you see it up, and you get the star, then you get the bridge. And it's sort of like to keep, you know, try and get you to climb in a way.
Yeah.
Because ideally, I want the player to be up on the bridge in a way, not go straight, you know, in the cave, the lower entrance and exit.
Mm-hmm.
The lower entrance that you're looking down to is a lot more difficult to get to. But I do find that a lot of Quake players will actually use that ruins. It's quite weird who actually will use the ruins straight away and who will actually explore through the bridge.
I guess, there are different players. Like, I imagine the type of players that would use the ruins more are the ones that are more inclined to try and, like, do, like, break the map, you know? Like, sort of do the unexpected. Like, oh, I wonder if I can climb this thing, you know?
Yeah, there's also a lot of players who are in a hurry as well, because you do get like there's the run and gun players who are always like rushing at everything and they want to get to the end. It's like, so they're always in a hurry. And then there's the people that like, you know, dawdle and slower and want to explore and see and, you know, find the other routes. So the start's trying to sort of give that idea that you can either run gun straight for like the map, or you can just like pause for a while and explore and see the other stuff. So
how did you get started mapping, by the way?
I got a job with Splash Damage. Took me a long time to apply and get there, and eventually I got a job at Splash Damage, and then I got a job at Raven Software in the States, and then I got a job with Crytek, and eventually I moved to like Canada, and then I sort of like left it and did my own thing.
So, your first ventures into mapping were professional?
No. I did a lot of community mapping, but I did Sin. I was working on that Ritual Sin game.
Oh.
Because it has a really good scripting language. I've always liked the scripting side of things. Quake has scripting, like entity scripting, but I wanted something a bit more than that. And Sin has that.
So Sin runs on the Quake 2 engine. Is it any different from Quake 2 in that regard?
Oh yeah. It has a whole complete like back end scripting language you can do. You can do all sorts of crazy stuff with it. But it's something for like, you know, when you want single player, you make stuff a bit more interactive. You generally don't get a lot of interactivity with Quake maps.
Yeah,
because you're not really slowing down. You know, everything you pick up is like you run over. There's no use key. Like when you hit things, you use things. It's streamlined to be like, you know, you're running all the time.
Yeah.
Whereas Sin slowed down a bit more, gave you consoles and interactive items. You know, it had a lot more sort of like, I suppose, slower pace, and I really liked that side of it.
Huh. Yeah, I guess it sort of shows in your work, because you've added like a fair amount of like scripting to Arcane Dimensions, right?
Yeah, definitely. It's mainly through like the entity state system, where you just like you can switch things on, off, reset them, and like this allows you to like create like 3D scripting chains and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's something I really enjoy, so a lot of my AD maps are like a bit crazy with the scripting.
Yeah, I've opened up Zendar, the AD version, and I saw all the links of like entities and that are targeting each other, and I just, my head melted.
Yeah, a bit crazy. The worst one is Firetop Mountain. The other thing is the AD maps. I also have a lot of I set up like a camera system, so you can create your own like YouTube videos for your map.
And
I have a lot of stuff that buried in the maps. You can sort of like implement, and you can look at them yourself as well.
Huh.
And it sort of like gives you special cameras, and it spawns different events and things like that.
Oh, is this in the current 1.7, or is this coming up?
Oh, yeah, you just need to use this impulse command called 145. And if you do that, when you load Zendar, and it will then give you all these cameras and take you through the map, and shows your story, and it's basically a YouTube video in the making.
Huh.
And I did that for Firetop and Metalmorn, and so there's quite a few of them I did.
Okay, I'm gonna have to go back to do that. I didn't know. I guess I didn't read the documentation well enough to see that.
It wasn't really like advertised. It was not something that, you know, I'm the only one in the AD team that did it.
Mm-hmm.
It was mainly for me. It was like something I wanted to do because I wanted to create videos that were actually in the maps as opposed to just simply, you know, setting up stuff and stills and stuff like that.
I guess I did want to ask about your mapping process. Do you tend to block out first and then art, or do you just art as you go, or how does that go?
I generally do prefabs. I always start with an art style. The texture and the style is usually where my maps come from, and if that actually clicks in some way, or it's like a theme that I like, or like set comes together really well, then that will actually be the start of it. And prefab maps are very chaotic. They're like usually bits all over the place. They're like different style, like texture right. They're really much into the shapes. And yeah, that's where it starts. And then if it selects something I like, then it becomes a more planned process. But the first part is very much like experimenting.
Yeah, that's very much how I ended up like stumbling into like that sort of being my process as well, is that I usually establish like a sort of swatch room, like a template room, right? And
definitely a good idea, because
yeah,
a lot of professional companies do as well, where you have like the artists that will give you like a palette or something to work with, or they set up the color tones, or they give you like themes or like artwork and stuff like that. So it's that sort of process, but like in a more editor sort of driven way.
Oh, I think we got a scrag in the wall.
Oh yeah, they go. They do fall into walls.
Yeah, they do some crazier stuff too. Like, I've seen them like fly through the void, and end up in parts of the map that they don't belong.
Same with fish as well. You can get the fish like doing crazy things as well.
Oh, this is always great. A nice little zombie bomb. You did send me a few shots of early development stages of this map, and the sort of template swatch room that you made. So could you speak a little bit on what the iteration process for this map was like?
It started with prefabs from Ivory Tower, which is the previous map. I liked the style. I wanted to explore a bit more. It certainly wasn't a city when I first started. It took a while before it became a city. Originally, it was very enclosed. It was going to be underground, sort of like self-contained, maybe like you see the sky peering through every now and then. The city part came a lot later. The first part to be created was the central courtyard. And it sort of developed from there, really, where it spiraled outwards. This area here sort of became was the first area to be sort of like you built outside of the courtyard in a way. There was plans to have two sides to the map. It was going to be like this side and the graveyard side. But this map was very much restricted by the at the time, you didn't have like BSP2, you didn't have like large map formats, you didn't have detail. Maps or like only have so many like polygons and verts and all these sort of things that you don't have nowadays. So I literally ran out of like resources for the map, and it sort of like ended up just being half the map in a way.
Wait, this was designed before Funk Detail was an entity?
Oh yeah, yeah, definitely. Oh yeah, definitely.
Oh,
yeah, I did a lot of work with a coder, Benji, his name, and we developed the Funk Detail idea, and it was like, well, I could, in order to actually compile this map, I needed to actually be able to do bits of detail, and he helped me sort of like with a compiler to add to it. Eric's tools weren't around at the time.
Huh. I was going to ask, how was that done before then? Were these just Funk walls so that they wouldn't be calculated into Viz or something?
No, they eventually did become detail, an entity called Funk Detail. now. But at the time, initially, they were just all like solid. Huh. You know, they're all world spawn. Pretty much when you opened up people's old maps, they were just like all world spawn. Hardly anybody did grouping, and they didn't do any like detail. Or so it was always quite tricky with the compile times. And I wanted a way to actually like do more detail, but make it a bit more easier going for like doing iteration, because this was half, and they just spawned them.
Man, that, I gotta say, when I found that when I did this yesterday, I laughed out loud very hard.
Yeah, yeah, that's because of Scampi. He was one of the testers, and he was always like going on to me about how he wanted a spawn somewhere in the map. So I did this just this closet with just a spawn in it, and it was black, and it was like, you know, just a way of just like trolling, you know, of the player in a way, because what spawns generally are about trolling, I think.
Yeah. Oh man, it's really funny though. It's just spawn. You think you're gonna get a treat because you found like a little hidden shoot button?
Oh yeah, it's nothing. It's just a spawn.
You said that you sort of started off with like the sort of central courtyard, right?
Yeah. So if you turn left, keep going left, and through there, this bit here is the central courtyard. This was the very first part to be built.
Okay.
It didn't have the floor the way it is. The floor was completely flat. Didn't have any of the actual like city buildings. It was very enclosed. It had the lifts here and the giant lift going up to the top temple area, and that's it. These were always like they were meant to be like they had ogres originally that came down, and I was very much into like presenting monsters on platforms and in previous maps. And it always was a way of like changing up the combat, because if something's moving on an actual platform, it can sort of like be more of a challenge, I always thought. So I had ogres coming down here on little platforms, and this was it. It was just this square, and it was just to see if I could do like the style I wanted.
Yeah, I guess monsters coming down on platforms has like a sort of, it's like sort of theatric, you know. It's a little bit
focus you, yeah. It definitely focus you actually looking at it. It's sort of like, you know, it gives you if you want a player to look at something, then putting a monster on something moving is definitely
Move. Yeah. The crazy thing about this city or this map is that, and I haven't really touched this part of the map yet, but there's an entire second story that is almost like, besides like the small section where the gold key is, the second story is almost entirely optional.
Yeah, totally. I mean, there's three levels to it. You've got like the bottom courtyard, you've got like a temple area, and then you've also got out on the rooftop area. I really wanted to try and create as much verticality as possible. Just trying to actually make it so you feel like you're constantly climbing up all the time. And these areas were originally linked by teleporters. They didn't go right round in a big loop, so it was something that added later.
Huh.
Yeah, you originally you couldn't even get out to the top roof section, because I was building to a deadline, because this was part of like an advent calendar competition thing, where it was like 24 of us all decided we're going to do something for Christmas 2013. And I only had like 6 weeks to build this, and it kept on getting bigger and taller and more vertical, and more stuff kept getting added. The map kept on breaking, and I kept on having compiler issues, and felt like, you know, I couldn't stop in a way, because it kept on going up higher and higher in levels.
Mm-hmm.
It was frustrating that way, in a way, because when you build the outer edge and you think that's it, then you say, oh, that'd be cool if you can go up here. And suddenly that outer edge that you built now actually where the player is, so you need another outer edge.
Oh, and now I somehow ended up on a roof, or on the roof section.
Yeah. And
completely on accident. I did not know about this path. I just thought, hey, why don't I jump here? Oh man, that's one thing I wanted to sort of address or bring up with this map, is that I don't quite grasp how you did it, but like, I have no strong, like, mental image of the routes in this map, like, because it's just, it's like this labyrinthian city. But then I never, ever get lost. So I have no idea how you pulled that off.
It uses a lot of like multiplayer ideas where you're constantly going around in loops. So if you get, if you're constantly going around in a loop, eventually you're going to get familiar with architecture and places. It all starts to connect together in your head in a way that you then can start navigating it yourself much easier. And as it keeps feeding around in more and more loops and exposing more and more layers, that you start to collect together, I think, in your head, and it becomes, you naturally start navigating, I think, in a way. So as long as you sort of like try not to do too many dead ends, or you actually allow places to drop down, then people will actually like look for their landmarks or places to go, and then they will actually naturally start, like, you know, wanting to explore more areas. It originally just started, as I said, like, you just start with the bottom layer, and you just keep stacking them on top of each other, and over time you just then start building more shortcuts in, and naturally the player is always jumping down, so they're always like finding routes themselves anyway.
Mm-hmm. Just like right there, I dropped down onto the rocket launcher. And this map sort of also, because of this layout, like, it beckons almost like a non-linear sort of approach. Like, it's, you can really play this in a number of ways.
Yeah, definitely. And it's also got the silver key layer on top of that as well, which didn't come into the map for the very beginning either. It was something that I used, in my early days when I was making Quake maps, I used to get quite a lot of demos. Most of it was posted on Funk, so everyone used to post their demos. And after a while, once you see like the same demo of like, or, you know, people always often pick the same routes. So I always got a bit frustrated where I wanted to keep seeing more routes, more surprises. So I started trying to do more and more like non-linear setups, because I wanted to sort of like see people discover them and give me, you know, more different demos in a way.
Mm-hmm.
So this sort of came from that thinking in a way that I wanted to see more unique demos. So I tried to make it more, you know, more options. I didn't expect anyone to see everything the very first time in a certain way. I was expecting them to either replay it or there'd be multiple people playing it different ways.
What are your feelings on that, by the way, on the idea of players missing out on content?
I don't mind. I mean, there's often chunks of maps I create, but I think some people never, and if they'd ever see it, well, that's cool. I mean, I don't think everyone has to see everything. I'm fine with that. I mean, if people want to explore and find more, they definitely will. It's whether they want to actually do that or not.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to actually like make it too linear, so you see everything. There's still the mystery that I want to keep.
I remember right here, I believe, is in the AD version, is where the plasma gun is.
Oh yeah, it's still there in this version.
But this time it's the lightning gun.
Yeah.
All right, so that's a nice little touch, by the way, that you added. Like, as you play through this map, like, most people will notice that you're progressing and you're constantly unlocking shortcuts, like shortcut lifts and shortcut teleporters and all that stuff. And I imagine that a lot of that had to come out through playtesting, right?
No, most of it just came from the building process. As the map grew vertically, more and more shortcuts were needed to actually connect it to create the loops. So as you create more and more loops, you need more and more shortcuts and ways to actually feed the player back in to, you know, to the main map itself.
Mm-hmm.
So playtesting was really about like balancing of the encounters themselves as opposed to the routes. I suppose I was confident enough with the routing what I wanted. Playtesting was really about like where is the spikes of like difficulty in the map, because did some person go left and to the right, and should there be more ammo that way, or should there be different encounters or stuff like that, really.
as I mentioned earlier, like how this is sort of a not this level has a you can it's very nonlinear. How do you approach pacing when designing like a nonlinear level like this? Since it's like it's kind of hard to force, you know, action beats at times if the player can go any which way.
It can be tricky. I mean, there were certainly some demos I saw where people just ran out of ammo because they went a really weird way that I wasn't expecting. The map is certainly not perfect. There's certainly flaws to the map. There's also a lot of like routes that reward you better than others, simply because I want, you know, there is a primary route I want. Whether the player takes it or not is up to them.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
You still got there's still a primary route through this map. It's just there's a lot of like choices along the way, and some players will just instinctively run that route. Some will then stop and get diverted, or think, oh, what's that? And suddenly they're off, like, you know, discovering different parts, and it's fine. But as long as they eventually all come back in, you're okay.
Yeah.
I mean, there's still the objective in this map is you've got to get one particular key, and it opens one particular door, and that's it. Then it comes to the final horde battle. It's just that you can like wander around a bit, a lot of other places in between, and you could even like, you know, finish this map with half of it missing, which I know some people do.
Yeah, that was definitely me on my first Arcane Dimensions playthrough. Like, I like hitting the score screen and seeing I have not killed like 100 monsters. I'm like, wait, what?
But... yeah, I suppose it's a weird way of actually doing it, because typically games like to be linear, because we all like to be completists in a way where we want to actually see and then do everything and then we can move on.
Mm-hmm.
But there is some people that just like to go back and explore and see other ways, or there's lots of people like do like routing for like speed runs and things, or just exploring different routes. Or I suppose, I mean, I know a lot of players do want everything to be seen, and with this sort of map you have to sort of give up on that. Really, you can't see everything in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
You often will have to, like, you know, maybe try a couple of times to see different things, but it then means the map isn't, you know, gives you more choices, do other things with it.
When thinking about like Quake, and most people are going to think about like the FPS combat aspect of the game, but you know, there's a lot of stuff happening between every trigger pull, right? Like there's a lot of the game is actually hinged on exploration. So like, how do you like to leverage the exploration element of Quake?
I think Quake is very much about two types of players, really. You've got the run and gun type players that will be trying to get through the map as fast as possible. And then you've got the explorers that are like, going to take a bit more time. And some community maps are aimed at certain types of players. Because I'm a bit more into exploring, I often find that a lot of maps don't cater to the style I like, so I try to do a lot more exploring in my maps, or give the chance you can do it.
Mm-hmm.
I think everyone sort of comes to their own style eventually for what they want in a map, and you sort of like it, you get used to that. And I think in a way where, you know, certain mappers present certain ways of doing things. I definitely like the exploring angle. But I tried to balance it with the combat as best I can. Like, you know, it's not like compulsory. I tried to like limit it. You're not like forced to like have to explore for like items in a way.
Yeah.
Which is why I did a mistake of that in an earlier map. The previous map, Ivory Tower, forced the player to actually find all the best weapons in sequence.
Huh.
And it became very frustrating for a lot of players because they couldn't find the secrets or open them, and they thought, and they were just like shotgunning everything to the very end, and no one really enjoys that.
Yeah, so I've definitely put weapon, like more than one weapon in secrets, and whenever, and when I, you know, I would ask for people for demos, And then I would see them play the map, and then they didn't get the secrets. So I'm like, oh no, what did I
do?
Yeah.
It's painful because they're just constantly like using shotguns or nail guns that are really slow, and they just simply weren't given that that extra weapon that made the game progress.
Mm-hmm.
It was a lesson I learned from Ivory Tower. I tried not to do that mistake with this version. This was sort of like the last of the series in a way. So the secrets are mainly to do with just exploration, like different routes, maybe extra ammo, funny spawn secrets and stuff like that. But they're not essential to the map, but they're there just to sort of like, if you want to explore. This map is really, I suppose, about the routes more than anything else.
I got a little bit too fancy for myself there, and I fell off the roof.
Oh yeah, there's plenty of ways back up though.
Yeah. So, let's see.
Not like a one-way ticket.
What are the biggest distinctions between this sort of concept of like a medieval city in like a more modern video game, as opposed to how it sort of plays out in Quake? Beyond the visuals, does anything sort of get shuffled up and jumbled and lost in translation once it like comes into Quake?
I think the problem with Quake is it's very much that the player moves like a really, really fast, and scale of things is very odd, so you never can really make that city modern scale, with doors the right sizes and windows in the right places, and verticality of like buildings is exactly how it should be. So everything in Quake has this enlarged size, so it's always going to be at odds with anything modern, because you're always going to be having to fix the scale all the time. That's fine. That I suppose that's is the consideration you're always going to need. You're going to have to go with the scale of Quake and give the player plenty to move around, because otherwise they'll just be bouncing off all the walls all the time.
Yeah. like a spawn.
Pretty much, yeah. You would be bouncing around, like, really frustrated, because you'd be stuck on architecture and, like, being pinned in corners and, like, everything would just be, like, picking on you, like, in weird ways, because you'll be fighting the architecture. Uh-huh. You're supposed to be fighting the monsters, really. But some maps can be very much like that.
By the way, I thought this was so clever when you're brought back to the courtyard for the final battle, and you like disabled like all of the lifts, and you closed all the paths and doors. Like, that must have been.
Originally it wasn't like that. There was like a big, it's gonna be a big arena fight where you're supposed to progress to the top of the temple, and once you unlock the gold silver doors, you then took an elevator up to the very top. Whole like arena that was going to be like on a big platform above the church area, and I had it all blocked out and I was planning it, and the secret garden was meant to be just like a vista for the top area. So you'd actually see when you look down from the top arena, there was like this big garden with like buttresses like attached to the church, and it was going to be like this whole like climb to get to the very top. And as I was detailing and adding more and more sort of like routes and options, and then I had like I was planning the facade, and it literally just technically ran out of polys. There was just a lack of like resources, so I thought, right, I'm gonna have to start reusing. And I reused the central courtyard because it felt like it was a good like combat circular cover. The enemies can move around.
And thematically, I think it's just, it has this like really neat effect where by the time you finish the map, it's like a slaughter. Like, look at all these bodies.
Yeah, it's the Horde. Is the Horde.
Yeah.
You were fighting it, that you came, and that was it pretty much. Like, part of the fun of it in a way. Literally, you are left the Horde around you.
Yeah. It's perfect. It worked out perfectly. So, man, were you inspired by any like particular maps and mappers for Zendar?
There's been a couple of really good like city town maps for Quake over the years. As the famous Cthulhu map, Shadow of Innsmouth, someone did. It was sort of okay. It was very good for its time. I had the concept images I was actually going from. I did like a lot of research on like trying to get like structures to how I wanted. I had Matt. There was Mad Fox. He posting that image. He then did his own version of that actual bridge archway himself in his map, Four Feathers. I don't think I don't feel like that because it was like quite a long time ago. I don't feel that there was actually a lot of influence from other maps in here. It was mainly just me wanting to create like a medieval town, I suppose.
So,
I still had a lot of more in me from Ivory Tower that I wanted to explore, like the structures. So it was driven more by Ivory Tower because that's where it started from. And then about halfway through all my revision numbers, I switched over to its own set and everything. But it was also rushed as well. It wasn't had that whole like mentality of like jam events where I was up against the clock, and halfway through the actual development of this map, I had a holiday planned with my wife, so the map sort of stopped, and then I went on holiday for a week, and I was like constantly thinking about it, and then I had to rush back, and then finish it as fast as possible to get it in time for the deadline. It was rushed in all sorts of different ways, and it kept on having all these technical problems,
It
and
doesn't
it was
show.
frustrating. Yeah, it was frustrating because it kept on falling over or breaking, or there was a lot of things that slowed it down that you didn't really want at that time because I knew I was up against the clock and I had to finish it. And the holiday in the middle sort of like just totally like stopped me in what I wanted to do in a way, but eventually it all worked.
Yeah.
And
When you revisited this map for Arcane Dimensions, did you try to sort of like round off those parts that you perceived as rushed?
yes. The AD version has a much larger roof area. It's a lot more developed, a lot more routes. There's a couple of extra routes to the actual gold key you can do. It's aimed at a different type of player for a start. It's not this type of player. It's more slower and it's like there's a bit more exploration involved in the AD version. It doesn't have the sort of like Metrovine sort of like silver key, like you can unlock bits and pieces at your own actual order. It was mainly more designed to be a linear route that you'd see as much of it as possible and then that's it. Whereas this one is a bit more like you can make as many explorations of it as you want and find your own routes. So it was aimed at a different sort of like player, I suppose.
Yeah, it sort of shows. I could definitely see that. This id 1 version of the map is like, it's just like non-stop action, and it's so fun. Like I love both versions. I can't I literally don't know like where, if I was to critique it, like what I would possibly say. It's just it's so crazy how these like the small touches like here and there, just with how the enemies come at you and the types of enemies specifically, how yeah, it really conveys like a really sort of different tone. This has a very sort of like classic. It's almost like slaughter in some like slaughter mappy in some parts. I mean, it's not slaughter mappy, but it's like there's just like tons of enemies that just come at you, and then but you have to find a creative way to deal with them. Whereas the original, it had a little bit of that, but it definitely felt different. It had a different vibe.
Yeah, it's not fast paced. It's also it doesn't have the silver key element to it,
Yeah.
which this does actually make this map quite unique. It was something that a lot of people really liked, because you you can explore the map in lots of different ways, and depending on which silver key door you open, depends on, you know, which rewards you get sooner than others. So it gave it like a bit more of a replayability, whereas the AD version was not designed to be like, you know, constantly replayed, because, you know, everyone's like, there's so many maps in AD that people aren't going to go back and replay them as much as they would a single map. So it's designed to you just moving forward. You play all the AD maps and then move on. Whereas this was came from a time when you had a map, and, you know, they were lucky if maps came out like once a month. Quake was in the 2000s, so it was a map that you played a lot more, and it was aimed at that.
Yeah, it shows that you sort of entertained this notion of like map replayability in some of your other maps too, like 1000 Cuts, for example. How that, for people who may not have played that map, that map sort of has like a gimmick behind it where each time you replay the map, it like loops in on itself. And I guess you did something with like the rune system.
Yeah, I used the runes again to actually tell you the cycle. A lot of Quake maps do that, where as you pick up runes, it constantly changes the map. There's been some really good versions of that system. Diggs is a good classic example of that. He did a map where it was like three different routes through the same map, depending on which rune you've got at the time. With 1000 Cuts, it wasn't that popular. I don't think people really liked the forced way it actually made you replay, and a lot of the mechanics weren't very obvious, and it was also rushed as well because it was a map jam, so it didn't really hit the same notes, I don't think, with this replay. And the other problem with 1000 Cuts was it didn't have like a, because it kept on resetting, it reset the flow, so you were constantly like, you know, starting afresh, and I think in a way that sort of interrupts the whole map and all. So you don't, you know, with a map like this, you know, it seems like beginning to end and that's it, it's done. But when you're recycling a map within runes, it's like a reset. Mm-hmm. And people feel like, you know, why am I redoing this again? I've just done it. But they don't, you know, don't initially realize why.
Huh. Well, I guess it's a concept that I find really interesting, and like some games have, like AAA games have like tried to pull this off. Like the first one that immediately comes to mind is Nier, NIER. The first one that came out, on PS3 and Xbox 360. That one had a system to it where the more you could like replay the game, I think up to 3 times, and each time you would play it, it would change the context of the story. And it's like a heavily story driven role playing game. And
yeah, I've heard the latest version has like multiple endings, like 7 or 8 different ways to end it, progress through it. My main influence, mainly for like replayability, would be Dark Souls series. Particularly the Demon Souls, where as you constantly replay it, the world changes in some way.
Oh yeah, with the white world, black world.
Exactly. World so tendency. Depending on which way you actually play and how you adapt to the world, depends on how things actually change in the world. But I don't think this maps to that scale, but it sort of like tries to take the idea that, you know, the routes you're picking are like, you know, it's the consequences in a way.
It does feel like it does like sort of hearken that Souls like level design, though, in the fact that you'll progress through an area and you'll unlock a shortcut and you're like, what, where does this this goes here, where I am. Okay, that happens a lot in Dark Souls, and it happens a lot in this map too. That's a design that I strive for, and I think you did an excellent job here of bringing it to Quake, nailing it.
Yeah, I really liked that sort of mentality of game design. I started experimenting it with Ivory Tower. Didn't quite work out so well, and this was sort of like the second version in a way.
I think I found a secret. Nope. Oh, wait.
It's that one at the top.
Oh.
Yeah, there's jumping stuff. I do like them in a way, but yeah, it's like ledge climbing. It's not the easiest thing to do in Quake because of the speed. But,
What is your favorite part of this map, by the way?
I like the church area, simply because of how it progresses. It sort of opens up in a way. I like it. It's sort of like I feel like it's a bit of a central area to me, the church. Something you come back to quite a lot. And it was originally meant to be the foundation of like the final area as well. So everything was like building up from the church in a way. I think there's some, I feel like there's some like, the front facade is really cool, but it's not really the same, I think, because it's simply just something there to sort of set the tone and that's it, because you don't often go back to the front very much. Whereas the church, you go back to quite a lot, because it's quite central. And even people miss this completely as well, because this is optional.
Yeah, I guess this is technically optional.
You don't have to bother with this at all. This is all completely optional. And there's lots of different ways in here as well, so... You've also got different ways to climb up to the top as well. On the side of by the altar, you go up to the altar and look at the columns on either side.
Steps.
So you can climb all the way up here, and then you can sort of not have to do the trap, and you try and get through that way, and not have to deal with like Horde at the bottom. You've got a way up here to get to the top route, because you can ultimately do. The upper route before the lower route, so you could get to the rocket launcher long before you get to it the other way.
Oh wow!
You come up here and you can go right round, and all this is connected on an upper loop, and then you can go across here, and you can literally go to the roof over there. You see, like you did.
Yeah.
Jump to that stained glass window, then across to the actual ledge, and then you go up the roof, and then you get the red armor, and then you get to all these places long before you should do.
Uh huh. Man.
So there's quite a lot of routes to it. Yeah, I mean, I know one True Purple told me he actually does runs using the invisibility ring to see how far he can get into the map just with that one ring. And, there's all sorts of inventive ways to actually get through the map. I used to get some demos from various people that have like done upper routes and lower routes and they've actually got to places that I didn't expect to. There's a whole upper area there you can go along.
Mm-hmm.
Connects right back around. You don't expect everyone to get these routes straight away. So, as I said, it's content that not everyone's going to see. Just have to accept that not everyone's going to see it all.
What was the most challenging part of the map to figure out, would you say?
I think the technical stuff of it was the worst. It kept on breaking so much. I don't think people nowadays appreciate the how good the tools are, or how easy it makes things, how easy it is to forgive like a lot of the mistakes, and how the engine literally just draws everything. You know,
mm-hmm.
You can quite happy like just stick your whole level in a box and still something you could release. Whereas you have to do a lot more like preparation of sight lines and trying to actually reduce detail and. You know, you try to actually not go over the top on sort of like, you have to viz block things, like you can't see the front of the actual facade from here.
You actually need to use like hint, right?
Yeah, you have to sort of like plan it out a bit more, and there's all this technical side of it. You don't really need to concentrate on so much nowadays because everything just draws everything. So, but in the time, it was technically a challenge. Yeah, it was cool. I liked the challenge. It wasn't really bad, but it didn't really marry too well with the actual deadline.
Yeah.
Which is not what I wanted at the time. It's easy to deal with this technical stuff if there's no deadline. When you're like, hey, I couldn't like postpone the deadline because it was an advent calendar. So it's like, couldn't say, well,
it's delayed Christmas.
Yeah, that's it. Sorry, folks. Christmas is going to be delayed.
Christmas is cancelled.
Yeah, basically. Shock has cancelled Christmas. But no, you can't. You can't do that. So I had to sort of like say, well, stuff's got to be cut. Like, the door to the left there, go back a bit, turn around a bit. And that door, that was supposed to be off to a graveyard. That was going to be a side of the map you were going to visit.
Huh.
There was like a whole section planned that was like, that was where you're supposed to get two keys. It wasn't just one key. You're supposed to get two.
Okay.
And it just ran out. Like, just wasn't enough space in the BSP. You know, they were limited. So it said, well, okay, I've got to cut that. Can't do it. And that's the way it went.
All right, yeah.
In a way, it was good because it forced you to reuse things a lot more.
I think reuse of space is an excellent level design technique. It's shocking how much of there these like different art forms and how interbred they are with sort of things that work and things that don't. Like when you mentioned earlier that typically when you work on maps, you do the beginning and the end last, right? And you basically do the middle section first. I do the same exact thing with music. And it works the same exact way. And you know what else is another super important factor of music that you need to be able to leverage is reuse of ideas. Because one thing that like really sort of gets people to enjoy music is having a setup and then setting up expectations and then paying off the expectation. And if a person is going to listen to a song that's going to constantly throw new sections new sections at them,
yeah,
they don't really ever get to a moment where they can just like start to like feel like, oh, my part is coming up, and then they groove to it, you know, like that never will happen. And
like the reward of a chorus or something like
yes
that.
Exactly, the reward of a chorus. And the, you know, the first time you hear a chorus, it's interesting. Like when you hear a song for the first time you hear a chorus, you might not be actively enjoying it, but you're listening to it to understand it.
Yeah,
but then the second or third time that the chorus comes on and it's more familiar to you, that's when you're like, oh, I like this part. I know this part. I'm enjoying this.
You're hooked in a way.
Yeah. So, and I feel like that aspect rears its head in many different mediums. Like, and I seriously think that's something in level design as well, is intelligent reuse of space has sort of a really cool expectation payoff thing for the player.
Yes, definitely, because it's like a familiarity in a way. You feel like comfortable all of a sudden again. You're no longer like feeling anxious because you're just constantly exploring new things. You're thinking, where's the familiarity?
Mm-hmm.
Suddenly it snaps back at you in a way with a loop. And you go, oh, okay. So you get those aha moments where you think, oh, okay, now I see how it links. You sort of build a mental map in a way.
When designing a map, do you first and foremost try to make yourself happy, or is there like some sort of, you know, imaginary like third party player that you're aiming for?
I suppose coming from pro background, you are ultimately like making maps for other people or making games for other people to enjoy. So I do sort of make maps for other people to enjoy. I certainly like make certain parts of maps that I designed just for me, but obviously, if you know, you're still ultimately like making maps for the people, otherwise you wouldn't release
them.
No, why would you release them if they're just for you? I think we all do enjoy actually like releasing things. We like to see the feedback, and I think as you release things, your maps get better. Because you'll start to pick up on ideas and styles, and your own style change. And so I think it's like a loop in a way that it's good for map to actually just release things.
Mm-hmm.
But also, there's obviously certain things that do work and certain things that don't. But you can also experiment in that, inside those loops in a way. There's definitely certain parts of the maps I make that are specifically for certain types of players. I suppose that's a better way of saying.
Yeah.
Certain parts of my map that are definitely designed for a certain type of player. And I suppose that's partly why it can be hit or miss, that, you know, sometimes there's just parts of the map that are not, and they will simply hate it, I know, because they just don't understand it, because it's not designed for.
I found that last that last scrag. I found it. I just got I got this epiphany. I was like, I know where he is.
In the garden.
Yeah, in the garden.
I do like the actual flying buttresses in that garden. Definitely that view in there. I loved when you actually first come into it, because it's two ways into the garden. I always hoped that people would come in the lower route. When you come, you get the silver key and you unlock and come in this way.
Oh.
But there's obviously the upper route as well, so you can come in both ways, but it's designed that you come in from the lower, really, so you get the whole like vista with the buttresses, and you've got the church, and then you're instantly snapped around by the actual like vor up on the ledge that drags you into the main courtyard.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I never considered that, because every single time I drop into this garden, I do have like a silver key. And then I always end up spending it on the door and then coming back and getting the other one.
Yeah, I'm sure some people have sent me some demos where you actually can screw up the silver keys. And there's definitely some places you can not get silver keys and the doors. But it was quite... This area in particular was bad because there's two ways into it, so it needs two silver keys in a way.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't, because you have to... You use the key to get out, but you then have to give another key so they can use it somewhere else.
Yeah, you have to refund it.
Yes, in a way. Yeah, this area was originally a maze. It was a hedge maze.
Ah.
Yeah, because originally you were supposed to see this from up on the roof. You weren't even supposed to be down in this area. You're supposed to be up there on the roof at the very top. And you're supposed to be standing up here on an arena and looking down. There was like a hedge maze you could look down on. And it had like the classic, you know, like... Hampton Court style hedge maze with like tall greenery, and it was like a special route, so you looked down and you saw the route, and then you would drop down into it, and then you could, based on you seeing the, you know, the route, you could work your way through it, and there's supposed to be a prize you could get at the very end, one item.
Oh yeah, showing off the solution of the maze overhead. Yeah, and then
exactly.
Okay.
So because you were supposed to come from the window, and then I thought no, I quite like it, and sort of merged in as a way, but lower route came in second. And I thought, oh, okay. And then the hedge maze just didn't work anymore. It felt a bit cheesy, and then just did away with it, but kept the hedges, because I thought, like, you know, it seemed like a nice touch to the whole area in a way. It made it more unique. And
yeah.
There's definitely people that never find this area.
No,
it's got a big secret.
I remember
it's got a big secret as well.
There was I was browsing the Quake category on Twitch, and I saw someone was playing Arcane Dimensions. And I clicked on the stream, and they were playing Horde of Zendar, and they were just in the church and they were doing the fight. And then I was like, "Hey, go in that back room. Go in that back room." And then they like read the chat. They're like, "Oh, this? Okay." And then they took the elevator up, and they just like walked out here, and they broke the glass, and they stepped out here, and then they picked up the quad, and then the Noor busted out of the floor. And then they were like, "Ah." it was pretty funny.
Yeah, I like the Noor fight. It
feels like a Dark Souls thing.
On the map it was, but it didn't work out, and we chose another boss instead for that. And it was the Noor is made by Matt Lunarin, which you had on your show. He made it. It's meant for his Lum SP2, I asked him whether I could use it, because it's such a cool model, and I know he had certain ideas for it, so I tried to adopt as many of those ideas as possible. And I wanted it to be a big presentation that, you know, when you pick up the item, it's there bursting out of the water. It mm-hmm. drains the actual water away as well, and then it sort of like it keeps spawning in more. But you've got like an SMG and a quad. I didn't feel like it was too unfair, but it's lightning resistant as well, which makes it even more, I suppose, frustrating, because everyone always saves their lightning most powerful weapon to, like, you know, try and cheese the final creature.
Yeah,
this one, no, you're not having any of that. You had to use what was given. It was a good. It worked out really well in the end. But
it really does. I was gonna say.
I know it frustrated people.
Oh yeah.
Frustrated.
Huh? Because it was hard.
Yeah, definitely, because it's constantly attacking. You've also got all the horde coming in from all the different areas at the same time. So you're having to pay attention. You can't just simply just keep looking up. It's also a vertical creature, so it hovers above you all the time. So eventually you start forgetting your periphery. You start to forget what's around you in a way, because you're looking up. And it's spitting balls. It's starting to deny the ground space to you. It's attacking you. It spawns in more creatures.
Maybe those players could afford to drop the difficulty a notch then, huh?
I don't know. I think Quake players generally, I don't know, they feel like they have to play at certain skill levels. Some do. I don't know. I don't know.
It's an ego thing. It's an ego thing.
I don't think so. No? I think everyone expects it to be a thing like that. You often hear the Twitch streamers that like say, right, we're going to play this game on the hardest level ever. And like, you know, they just end up being decimated like hours on end. You know, I think there's that sort of like, you know, mentality. But yeah, this skill levels are I definitely spend a lot of time trying to balance. I try to tone down the attack directions. I try to I don't try to tone down the quantity too much, but more like the types that you're facing. You're facing from certain directions, less on lower skill levels. You're given access to more resources. There's more breathing space, so you can retreat if you're getting overwhelmed. I quite like the loop in this level, where you start out in the sewers and you end up in the sewers. And there's teleporters down below, so even if you go down, you can still get back up again. But yeah, it's this whole, like, you know, this is where you started and this is where you end. And it's like, you know, I just wanted to create that sort of symmetry to it in a way.
It's this is a really neat moment when you finally do drop down into the sewer, because when you initially start here, you don't really have context of like what's above, like where this is exactly. You just sort of think this could be some room isolated out in the space of the map or something. But
exactly, yeah.
But in reality, you're underneath the meat of it all, which is really cool. Yeah. So I guess I always like to ask everyone this. If you were to give a newer mappers a piece of advice, what would it be?
I would recommend that new mappers always keep making new stuff and keep releasing it, as it's the only way anyone's ever going to get better at it. I think it's very easy just to keep like creating pieces and not doing anything with them. You know, just keep chucking them on like a prefab pile. Also, the releasing of maps is good because it stops you going back and constantly just keep adding more and more, sort of
George Lucas syndrome.
The release is the final and that's it.
Uh-huh.
Pushes you forward. I mean, there's plenty of mistakes I've got in all my maps. I'm not going to go back and like keep fixing them and keep making revisions. It's a bit different for AD because it's like a complete package each time we can tweak things.
Mm-hmm.
But vanilla maps were like a slice, that was it, done, dusted, end of story, next map. I think that actually is quite good in a way. Something that new mappers should definitely get into a habit of is finish the stuff, release it, and just move on.
Try
different styles.
That's the same advice I also have given people who have asked me like about like steps to on how to improve in like music production. And what I always tell them is that you need to make songs. And what you need to do is that you need to make a song and you need to finish it and you need to move on to the next song and improve just one tiny thing. Just pick one thing from your previous work and just improve it a little bit for the next one. And just do that for a year.
Yeah.
And then by the end of that process, you're going to be a pro.
Well, I'm not going to guarantee that.
I mean, that's, you know, that's just optimism. Optimism.
Yeah, definitely. But I mean, it's you should definitely keep moving forward, because you will get better each time, and you'll start learning from your mistakes, and the feedback you get will sort of give you an idea of what is like, you know, things that do work and don't work. And also, you really need to try and keep pushing forward with styles, like trying more and more different styles, try more and more texture sets, more and more like encounter setups, you know, try your hand at a slaughter map or like a horde map or exploring map, or try your style like puzzle maps, or just keep on trying different things as much as you can. If you're finding like your current map's exactly like your previous map, then just shelve it and do something else. You'll just be repeating.
Yeah.
It's also, you have to be careful, I think, with styles, that some styles are quite overwhelming. Like they're so strongly set up that when you come to actually create something from it, it can be quite difficult to create your own version from it in a way. Mm-hmm. Create something that's you. Like an example is honey. The honey theme is very well strong and realized, and everyone's sort of like, you know, we all love doing honey maps, but they all literally are just honey maps.
Yeah.
There's very few actually add or make it anything more than just a honey map. I think that can be quite difficult, especially if you come across a style that's very strong and set in a way.
Yeah.
So had all the examples and prefabs done for you in a way.
I guess a big part of becoming any sort of artistic or creative person is one of the biggest hurdles that you are going to initially have to get over is establishing your own voice as a creator.
Definitely, yeah.
As a creator. Definitely. It can in some cases be like quite the laborious process. Like, you know, you're gonna have to end up like, at least the way that I suggest that you go about doing it in music is by you copy what you like and then you change.
Yeah, definitely.
You copy what you like and you change something for you, like something that you want.
Yeah, imitating some styles is very good in the very early stages.
Yes.
It sort of gets you into the tool. Gives you like familiar like prefabs and styles, and no longer have to like think of new ways to create things and move. You're sort of like, you know, you've got a template already. Someone's giving you like a box of paints already.
Yeah.
So when you see a strong style, you can just like, oh yeah, I know how to do this. I saw that in this map, and I can just take that and make my own version. But it's mm-hmm. getting you into that building loop that eventually then you can start like doing your own style.
Yeah.
I often used to like, the thing is, when you first release maps, it's probably the freest time you're going to be, because no one has any expectations of what you are. No one has like your expectations of what your style is. You know, you get people like, they roll their eyes and say, oh yeah, that's such and such map, and these maps are always X, Y, Z. But when you're new, you don't have that. You can do any style, any sort of like theme, anything you want. And that is probably, that's a good feeling when you first start out. I mean, I think that's what new people forget, is that no one knows what your style is, so you can do anything.
Yeah, no one has any expectations of you.
Exactly, because as you get more and more maps under your belt, you can start to pick up a style, and people then, you know, they categorize you and they say, oh yeah, you're X, Y, Z. No, I'm not going to play any more of your maps because they're this or that. But when you're new, you just, well, you can do whatever you want. No one has any history for you, right? That could be quite sort of like cool for like new people. And it's probably something they probably feel afraid or frightened that they're going to be like not accepted their new map, or it's going to have this or that. But it doesn't matter, because, you know, you're fresh. You can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
It's quite cool.
That can be a little bit intimidating too. Like once you start putting more and more detail into your maps, the further you sort of progress as a mapper, and like having that like almost like that sword of Damocles looming over your head of like, well, like at what point was this all just going to collapse on me and I can't detail any better or anymore? Like...
Definitely, yeah. I think there's definitely a lot of pressure with the screenshots. I mean, you can't show gameplay in a screenshot, so everyone is all instantly attracted to maps via the screenshot, so they do hold a lot of power and a lot of influence. So mm-hmm. there's always that need to be like, I need to push my visuals better to get this and that. And, you know, sometimes you don't have to. Sometimes it can just be like, you know, it can just be enough to just get people's interest, and then you can do something different after that. But I've often like tried to just do maps under aliases, and I've often like experimented with the idea of like creating a map under an alias, and I like I go to all the effort of like hiding all like, you know, my techniques or styles, and like I change all the textures around and sort of like that. But, you know, to try and make it to, if someone opened up the map file, they wouldn't know it was me and all that sort of stuff. But I think after a while, you get so used to like the ways you create things, you sort of like, it comes like a fingerprint in a way of your map.
Uh-huh.
It's like, okay, you know, you can't really hide your style in a way. I think it's fun to actually try and get the actual style you want, though, but it takes a while to find it. I think as long as people don't try and rush to try and find the style, then they actually enjoy like the creation and the fact they're going to keep making mistakes to start with.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, the community is very helpful, and there's tons of like examples, maps, and there's tons of like, you know, people that release their source files as well, so you can just look at theirs and see how they did things and ask them, all that sort of stuff.
So, I guess we've come to the end of our journey here in Zendar, and I wanted to ask, like, or rather not ask, but I wanted to say, like, this map, and along with a lot of your other works that I've played, and like specifically like Arcane Dimensions and stuff, like I find like those are in my mind and in the canon sort of like video games and like first person shooters, like I categorize that as like the as part of the important works. Like I feel like the like there's a certain like ripple like effect that can happen when something really important happens that like causes like a lot of like knock-on effects to occur. And I think with like with all the amazing and content that you put out with either, you know, these like standalone releases and what eventually became Arcane Dimensions, I think that is a super, super important piece of... It's become a super important piece of gaming history in my mind. I don't think that things would be exactly the same without it. I wouldn't be here talking to you about this because I would have never gotten back into Quake.
I don't know. Maybe you might have. You don't know. I mean, there's certainly like a lot of very talented mappers in the Quake.
But I would have never. They definitely would have existed, and they would have been great, super talented. But I would have never found out about them because, the sort of the buzz and that Arcane Dimensions managed to create just because of how high quality it was is what lured me back into the scene, and for many many other people as well. I know this holds true, and I gotta say, like that's to me personally, that's like a really big deal. So I'm like really honored to have you on the show.
Thank you.
Because like I said, it's had a big impact on my life as well. Beyond just gaming, like, you know, I make Quake 1 maps now, and that's become a sort of like healthy mental, you know, outlet for me to just sort of relax and blow off some steam. And I would have never gotten to this point if it wasn't for Arcane Dimensions. And you know, I love, my favorite part of maps is the artwork and the detailing, getting things to look pretty and stuff. And also, like, the styles that you've established, too, like, resonated really strongly with me and other people, too. And so, like, these are things that are important to me. And I think, and it's not just to me, it's important to a lot of people. So I hope that you realize that, like, you know, you are a very humble guy. And... but you know, you have every right in the world to be a little bit more arrogant. This is your, everything that you've done is just so incredible. And I wanted to thank you for, doing all that and coming onto my show to speak with me.
Oh, no, I appreciate it. Thank you. I listened to a couple of your new shows and thought it was really cool. You were like really friendly and easygoing. It was like, it was really nice. It's like really cool to actually, you know, not everyone can like, you know, make guests feel relaxed and easygoing. So it's definitely a very cool thing.
Huh, and I thought, you.
Yeah, I'd be cool to actually do that. Yeah, it worked out. It was cool.
Yeah, I had a blast. And I hope, you know, with AD 1.8 potentially coming out somewhat in the near future, to maybe have you back on for that, so we can actually talk about AD, because we mentioned it here and there, but
yeah, I think it'd be best for a different episode. I mean,
oh yeah, definitely.
There's a lot more stuff going on. There's also Val is finally going to actually release one of his mega maps.
Yes,
so it'd be cool. So there's all that as well. So you definitely want to speak to him about that.
Oh yeah, that's already reserved.
There's a lot of new like stuff coming into the pipeline. So yeah, I'm always amazed at like the new stuff that's going on, like in where people are actually using AD. Very cool. So yeah, hopefully the new stuff is going to be like even more toys and things to play. Yeah, hopefully that will be soon. As I keep saying, soon, but yeah, hopefully it'll be soon. And it would be good for a different episode. Definitely.
Awesome. Well, anyways, yeah, we're here at the end of our journey. And Simon, I just wanted to pass the mic off to you. Do you have any final words to close us out?
Yes, thank you very much to everyone. It's been it's pretty cool. The reception and feedback from all the AD project's been very cool. And I'm glad to see, like, you know, it's being used in ways I never thought it would be, which is very cool. Yeah, thank you.
All right. And thank you once again. And, you know, this has been The Horde of Zendar by Simon O'Callaghan. Thanks for watching, everybody. I'll catch you later.